In the last video, the Onin War began, causing Kyoto to burn in the fires of battle as clans all across Japan drew their swords to enter the conflict. Eventually, the two main instigators of the war, Yamana Sozen and Hosokawa Katsumoto, would exit the conflict when the succession of the shogun's son, Yoshihisa, was confirmed in 1469. Yet, the conflict would continue on as many clans still refused to back down, ravaging the countryside. It was in these final years of the Onin War that gave rise to the Ikko Ikki. By the year 1475, the map of Japan was changing as clans rose up to join in the fighting. However, the most unfortunate victims of this bloody conflict were simple civilians, farmers whose fields were pillaged and burned, and merchants whose inventory and trade were raided. Many fell into hard times of despair. Most prominently, those who lived in central Honshu, where the fighting was at its thickest. It was in these dark days that people would turn to religion in hopes of salvation, making it the perfect time for one such monk to spread his teachings. His name was Rennyo. Now, religion in Japan is an entire video all on its own, so I'll keep things simple here. In the days of old, Japan was a melting pot of various Asian faiths. One such sect of faith being Pure Land Buddhism. Pure Land Buddhism is akin to Mahayana Buddhism, a more spiritual form of Buddhism, whose practitioners view Buddha as more godly than other sects, often calling him the Amida Buddha. Pure Land Buddhism believes that in order to truly find enlightenment, one must be reborn into an uncorrupted world, the Pure Land. In the 1200s, a monk named Shinran would reform a sect of Pure Land Buddhism known as Jodo Shinshu, focusing more greatly on the roots of Pure Land teachings and challenging the ways in which Buddhism had been practiced in Japan at that time. However, Jodo Shinshu would endure a hard existence, as his teachings were not widely known or accepted, and at times it would come into conflict with other various sects of Buddhism. This brings us to 1457, when Rennyo became the head of the Jodo Shinshu Hongonji Temple in Kyoto. From here, he worked towards converting people to the Jodo Shinshu faith all across central Japan. And to the dismay of other Buddhist sects in the area, Rennyo was successful. Eventually, monks from Mount Hiei would label Rennyo's Jodo Shinshu teachings as heretical, prompting them to send warrior monks to attack Honganji in 1465, leading to it being burnt to the ground, and forcing Rennyo into hiding as he continued to be hunted down. 2 years later, in 1467, the Onin War began, throwing central Japan into chaos. Rennyo wished to re-establish Honganji Temple far from Mount Hiei, and far from the battles occurring across central Japan. This led him to believe the province of Echizen to be the best answer, as it seemed out of the reach of Mount Hiei, and already contained other Jodo Shinshu temples. Before establishing the new Hongonji, Rennyo went about visiting the other Jodo Shinshu temples throughout the province. Eventually, visiting congregations, and sharing his thoughts, interpretations, and criticisms of Jodo Shinshu Buddhism, returning to the root of Shinran's teachings. His words echoed throughout the province, attracting more and more to hear him speak. Soon, thousands of farmers, merchants, masterless samurai called Ronin, and even lower-ranking samurai began to follow him. Eventually, in 1473, neighboring Kaga province would become embroiled in a civil war, leading to the followers of Rennyo joining the fight, largely to expand their own influence. They now called themselves the Ikko Ikki, the single-minded school. In time, Kaga province would fall fully under the control of the Ikko Ikki, just as Aichizen had. In 1475, during the waning years of the Onin War, having converted both Aichizen and Kaga province, Rennyo would see the need to make his way back towards Kyoto, in aims to aid the common people, who for years now had been suffering from the chaos of the war. He no longer worried about being attacked by monks from Mount Hiei, as he now marched with a force much larger than any threat Mount Hiei could muster up. As he traveled, his followers dispersed his writings to the common people so that all could know his teachings. This led to many more falling under his influence. In 1477, the Onin War finally came to an end, as the last of the rebellious daimyo finally backed down, following Ashikaga Yoshihisa taking the position of shogun from his father. However, the damage of the Onin War had already been done, as it would leave an impact that would last for over 100 more years. The shogunate crippled, the emperor powerless, and Kyoto left in ruins, giving way to hordes of looters who moved in to ravage the desolate capital and countryside. Although one could still point to Kyoto and say that is where control exists, that was simply no longer the truth, rather a lie. The emperor, the shogun, and the imperial court were now little more than simple figureheads. True power now existed in the hands of daimyo across the country, who were now free to further their ambitions, attacking their enemies and growing their territorial holdings, becoming rich and mighty. The Sengoku Jidai, the age of the country at war, had begun. By 1496, Rennyo retired from the world, moving out of Kyoto to live by himself in a small rural area to the southwest known as Osaka. Here, he would later die in 1499, but not before being found by his followers, who would build a temple where he lived. In time, this temple would grow in size and numbers, eventually coming to be known as Ishiyama Honganji, the most heavily fortified temple in all of Japan, and the headquarters of the Ikko Ikki, militant monks and champions of the common people. So, what can we learn from all this? The Onin War would ravage the lower classes of society, causing many to adhere to the teachings of Rennyo, a Jodo Shinshu monk who would ignite the Ikko Ikki movement, as the Ikko Ikki would go on to impact Japan for the next 100 years. And as the war came to its end, in the ashes of the capital, authority could no longer be found. The many daimyo now essentially had the freedom to go about making their own wars with no repercussions. Thus, even though the event known as the Onin War came to an end, many more countless wars were now to follow in its wake. In the next video, we will look at the first of the powerful clans that would begin making names for themselves in the aftermath of the Onin War. Thank you for watching, and don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most informative.